I did, I have wrestled a couple of bears. The place where I work now is Bear County. And when I went there, the Center for Healthcare Services, which is the Behavioral Health Authority for Bear County, which is San Antonio, was bankrupt. It was $6 million in the hole. We had an employee union because the staff there hated working at the center. The center was always in the newspaper for bad things. And so my wife looked at me, and I was the state director of the Texas, whoops. I was the state director of the Texas Department of Mental Health and Retardation for that. And my wife looked at me like, are you crazy? You know, and I said, no. I said, I want to go do some good, and you know, I think that's a place to do it. So she said, well, you finally got your third bear. So I wrestled in college and for the United States, and some all-star teams that went to different countries. But I also had a chance to wrestle a couple bears. So my granddaughters call me Papa Bear. Just a little bit of about me. I started off just like you all. I've had every job that you could think of having in my career growing up. So I always wasn't a leader or administrator. I did research with autistic kids. I worked in a state school and changed diapers. White bottoms of adults that are profound, severely retarded, and I can kind of go on and on and on. So I have a profound gratitude to everyone who touches consumers and family members directly. And so we've got this saying at the place I work, if you don't serve our ultimate customers, you are family and consumers, you serve the people that do. So yes, it's my job to solve problems, give resources, and develop people. It's so good to see all these young faces in the room because we need a new generation coming up to continue that struggle. So I want to talk a little bit about myself. Just a couple things real quick. We got the American Psychiatric Association's Gold Award, the National Council's Top Award, CNN named me a mental health warrior a few months ago, and we get people visiting three or four times a week from someplace in the United States. We have seven or eight countries who have also visited, and Sibelius visited, two of the drug czars visited, and what they always say is they're impressed with our unique services, but what they're really impressed with is how'd you get everybody to work together. And that's the thing I'm so impressed about your community, you know, is you have Hutch and you have county commissioners, you got the sheriff, all you all who are community leaders who are willing to do the tough job, and that's reach out to people that are very ill, many times have co-occurring disorders, and treatment resistant. So let me talk a little bit about our outcomes and about the problem. I'm going to talk about the problem first. So we were just talking about law enforcement. So there were 870,000 people in the United States in city or county jails last night. 65 to 70% of those folks were in jail because of either an alcohol or drug problem or a behavioral health issue. Most of those people have a co-occurring disorder. So we have a sobering and detox unit that almost all the people are brought by law enforcement. And so we get people to our detox, we get them sobered up, we find that they've been self-medicating, that they have an underlying emotional disturbance or a mental illness. People come to our mental health crisis unit. Once we get stabilized psychiatrically, we find out they've been self-medicating with alcohol and drugs for a long time. So law enforcement deal with our folks all the time. It's just so usually they don't know it. In Bexar County, we do so much mental health screening that we know it. So let me give you an example. In 2003, the Texas Jail Standards Commission was threatening to shut down our county jail for overcrowding and their horrible conditions. The year before that, we started training law enforcement officers in 40-hour crisis intervention training. Of course, what's important there is over 20 hours of it is role playing. And in 2003, we actually opened up our first little crisis unit as a diversion alternative. The county brought in an expert that says you need to build another 1,000 beds onto the county jail. The county actually decided to buy jail space from other counties to get the population down so they can meet the standards because the federal judge started to look into the jail because of rights violations. So, to make a long story short, we never built the additional 1,000 beds on the county jail. We grew by 600,000 people last census period. And I was just telling the sheriff, our sheriff is a retired two-star general. She and I were at my crisis center in our conference room when Senator Cornyn, who is the U.S. Senate whip, pinned a bill that just passed Congress, by the way, both the House and the Senate. It was in that omnibus bill before they rolled all the mental health legislation together that would help pay for this early intervention crisis training and also the intensive outpatient commitment law. So yeah, hopefully you all can expect some dollars to help pay for some of the things I'm going to talk about today, because the kind of bill, I mean, patterned a lot of his bill and funding around what we do in Bexar County. So I turned to the sheriff, and you know, I think I told you she's a retired two-star general, but she also has a brother with mental illness who died. So you know, she really has worked hard in making sure that people aren't criminalized because they have an illness. And you know, she's a powerful spokesperson. In fact, she's testified before Congress on a couple occasions recently. So I turned to her and I said, what's the census in the jail today? There were 999 empty beds in the jail that day. So that's effectively 2,000 empty beds from 2003 to, you know, 6 months ago. What would it cost the county to build another 1,000 beds onto the county jail just to build a facility? It's like $60,000 a sale or something like that. And then to operate it for over 10 years. Then the fact that we have 1,000 empty beds in the county jail now. So our county is totally behind this program. So would everybody agree that people being criminalized and going to the wrong place is a big problem for society? It's very costly to counties, and it's costly to families and people with mental illness. It's a very painful experience, and people shouldn't be criminalized. So what about the homeless? Do you have a homeless problem here?
Yeah.
We do in San Antonio. Okay, so we already have determined there's a big problem in jails with people with mental illness being criminalized. So if you look up cost to the taxpayers of the homeless, I did this about 6 years ago for the city of San Antonio because I wanted them to help me fund this crisis center. And I found all kinds of studies, and by the way, you all already know this, the chronically and persistently homeless are people with mental illness and addiction problems, right? Usually co-occurring. So when I looked this study up, the cheapest study I saw that year was $30,000 it cost the taxpayers for a homeless person. They have lots of contact with law enforcement. They're in and out of jail. They're in and out of emergency rooms. And the most expensive study I saw was done by the Scripps Center in San Diego, California. The Scripps Center is that famous place where there are several Nobel Prize winners, so the research they do is top-notch. The county actually hired them to look at the county's high utilizers, their super utilizers. 257 people in San Diego County cost the county $16 million. Okay? So homeless, big problem, very costly, right? And you know, painful. I mean, who wants to sleep out in the hot and cold and mosquitoes and you know, be brutalized? If you're female, you've been brutalized in every horrible way you can think of, and it's just wrong. But these people are self-medicating with alcohol and drugs, and they're hard to engage. And so you got to do different. Even if they had a benefit, they probably wouldn't show up, you know, to primary care. If they did show up, they wouldn't be welcome. They have behavior problems, they have hygiene problems, you know, they would be scaring the moms in those clinics. So, you know, we have primary care, and we treat these people with dignity and respect. And so that's, you know, the homeless, big problem, right? Very costly to society, plus, you know, the pain and suffering that goes along with it for the individual and their families. Another problem, is healthcare a big problem in this community? Yeah, we're talking about healthcare at the national level now, and the healthcare premium's gone up 20%. Well, I'm here to tell you that the people with severe mental illness die at least 25 years sooner than the general population. In Texas, it's 29.4 years sooner And that study was done by SAMHSA and NASHPA, the National Association of State Mental Health Directors, several years ago, when Dr. Ron Manderscheid was at SAMHSA. And so they die early, but guess what? They're not dying of the mental illness or their addiction problems. You know, a lot of these people go undiagnosed, so they're self-medicating with alcohol and drugs. What does that do to your body? The mentally ill smoke, way over half the cigarettes are smoked in the United States because it has a calming effect. These people are so dysfunctional, they don't have jobs, so they don't have insurance. So they never get to primary care, they never get to early intervention, prevention, or disease management. So they're dying these poor deaths, and they're unfunded. So Malcolm Gladwell, y'all know about Malcolm Gladwell, he wrote The Tipping Point and a lot of other stuff. He wrote an article for The New Yorker called Million Dollar Murray. And he's a nerd, you know. He does research, he's an introvert, but he's this marvelous guy. His mother was raised by, his mother is a psychiatric nurse, and so he's very interested in the mentally ill. She raised him right. And he was a health and science editor at the Washington Post before he started writing books. So he wrote an article for the New Yorker called Million Dollar Murray. And his contention was, what's really driving up the cost of healthcare in the United States is not what we think it is. It's these unfunded people that are million-dollar patients. And there are a lot of them. So they're dying early. They're dying congestive heart failure and liver disease and diabetes and all these horrid diseases. And, you know, they get in emergency rooms. They get better in the hospital. And so they're very expensive. So they're unfunded. So in today's world, Florida didn't accept the affordable health care dollars, right? You didn't take Obamacare. We didn't either. But your state is reaping some of the negative factors around Obamacare. So the idea was everybody would have health insurance. So why would you give hospitals money for unfunded patients if everybody's going to be funded? So in Florida, all your hospitals are losing what they call disproportionate share or dispro funding. That goes down every year. So they used to get funded, partially funded for these uncompensated patients. Now they're not, they're getting squeezed. Also, if you have high readmission rates into your hospital, in other words, you go to the hospital, you get out, you come back, if that reaches a certain percent, you lost 5% of your Medicare funding this year, 3% the year before, and 3% the year before that. So I don't know this for a fact, but I'll guarantee you, you have hospitals in Florida that are closing down because of those two reasons, probably in rural areas, okay? So the medical industry is starting to figure this out. You know, they used to didn't care because they got funded, and when they looked at their demographics, these people that were unfunded weren't dying of their mental illness. They're dying of all these other things. But there's been so much study recently on who are these people that are going to the hospital that are unfunded, who are these people who are getting readmitted over and over again. Mm-hmm. You know, so the medical community, in fact, I was just asked to go to Alabama and speak to the Alabama Hospital Association because Patrick Kennedy and I spoke there about a year and a half ago, and I've been back two or three times. So these hospitals are starting to figure out that these folks need treatment. And so some of our biggest advocates, and I'll still tell you a story here in a little bit about what's happening in our community with the high utilizer program and in the hospitals. So if you look at disease burden, the Gates Foundation actually funds a unit at the University of Washington that the World Health Organization uses now. And so which diseases actually cost society the most in early death, loss of productivity, and actual health care costs? Whether it's the National Institute of Mental Health or World Health Organization, you know, three or four of those top diseases are behavioral health in nature. Okay? So, the jail, big problem. The homeless, big problem. Healthcare, uncompensated care because these people go untreated, big problem. What about child protective services? Do you have a lot of abused, neglected kids in your community? Yeah. So we're not very smart. Most CPS organizations are really designed to be safety programs. In other words, we identify these kids who are being abused, neglected. We take them out of that environment to protect them. Many times we re-traumatize the kids because a lot of shelters won't accept older kids with younger kids, but yet it's the older brothers and sisters that are protecting the younger ones and feeding them and clothing them and nurturing them. And so we traumatize these kids all over. We don't spend a lot of money unless a kid is just blatantly mentally ill. We hardly spend any money on therapy. You know, I'm talking about trauma-informed care and that kind of stuff. When do kids age out of foster care in Florida?
18.
Same thing in Texas. So we take these traumatized kids who are broken, and in fact, I was lecturing my community. We just had our 50th anniversary, and so we had this big celebration, big fundraiser, and we raised about $400,000. So there were a lot of people in the room who paid $25,000 for a table. So in San Antonio, so we had a lot of community leaders and big business people, and I chose to talk about Child Protective Services because it's such a big problem in Texas. And my wife was sitting in the audience, and I said, you know, my wife and I have two sons. One's a doctor, and the other one's an international business person. In fact, that's a Michigan lady. My other son got his master's in international business at the University of Mexico in Mexico City. And my other son and his wife are physicians in Seattle. And so I told the crowd, if my wife and I had aged our sons out of our family when they were 18, they probably wouldn't have done too well. But we take these broken children. Yes, ma'am.
Hold actually is the 21
Oh, that's good. So, yeah. So
there are some criteria to that, but some of these kids, because they've identified that they're having a hard time at 18 years dropping them off, that they're allowing certain extensions or something.
That's wonderful. Come testify in our state because we're talking about this right now. So they're actually just talking about adding more caseworkers because they're blaming them when these kids don't do well. And anyway, I just want to talk about, you know, the fact that treatment and behavioral health issues touch our society in so many different ways that are so costly to society. So you want to show the video or two? The picture's worth a thousand words. Show a couple videos and I'll go through my slides and get into the...
It's one of several police shootings involving people with mental illness.
18-year-old Keith Bynell struggled with schizophrenia. He wasn't violent, and all they wanted was help getting him to treatment. Seconds later, the officer shot and killed him.
Murdered our son for no reason. Another disturbing video that raises questions about the treatment of the mentally ill behind bars.
He would hear voices.
The extraction team restrained him. Minutes later, the 33-year-old was dead.
Jails are the number one mental health facilities across the country. They house more mentally ill person versus any hospital, any psych facilities, any anything. They're patients, not prisoners.
Mental illness is the only disease that when you're in a crisis, the cops are called. If you're having a heart attack, you don't call the police.
People with mental illness are being criminalized instead of being provided treatment.
These kind of jails and law enforcement, that's public safety. That's where you end up.
There has to be some sort of solution, some sort of help for people who are suffering from mental illness and become involved with the police.
Jeff was the youngest of our four. He was finally diagnosed a paranoid schizophrenic. When he was totally out of control and very frightening, I would have to call the police on him. They didn't know what to do.
I would get calls all the time when I was on patrol for a person who was in a mental health crisis. I had no clue how to handle it. And I would just keep getting the repeat calls every couple days or every week to the same house, the same person. And I just accepted it that, this person's just going to be a repeat caller.
We decided very early on that we needed to address folks that were nonviolent misdemeanor offenders that were truly being put in jail because of their illness. We knew that it was law enforcement that were first responders and that they would be the ones that would be in contact with individuals in crisis.
So we decided what we would do first is train law enforcement officers in 40-hour crisis intervention training. So they're trained to recognize mental illness. When they come up on somebody that's got kind of strange behavior, they're not using their command voice and their command presence like they're taught in the academy. they realized right away that this person has a problem. We brought together a bunch of law enforcement officers from the sheriff and the San Antonio Police Department, and every one of them didn't want to be there. So I heard things like, I'm a cop, I'm not a social worker, I don't believe in these heavy threat programs, and this is a bunch of BS.
Before I went through the 40-hour CIT training myself, I didn't have the resources on how to handle mental illness. Well, now, it's way different. You know, I have confidence that when I go into someone's home, if they are experiencing some type of, you know, mental health crisis, that I can get them to the right facility, and then I may never hear from them again.
I'm a mother, I'm a sister, I'm a friend, I'm a voter, I'm a volunteer, I'm all these people. I contribute to my community, and I have a mental illness. My diagnosis is major depression with psychotic features, dissociative identity disorder, and panic disorders. I've done the presentations to CIT training, and I tell them, I want to be treated the way you want your mother to be treated if she was ever diagnosed with a mental illness. If I'm in a crisis, you know, I'm having a crisis, and I don't understand what's going on around me.
In incidents with people who have mental health issues, it's unfortunate to see the ones that result in the use of deadly force where an officer didn't have CIT training, and possibly armed with that kind of information, that kind of training, outcomes may have been different.
I never knew each morning when I got up what I might find. He began to talk about a fire in the garage. So I thought, would he, without knowing what he's doing, start a fire? How much danger is he in, and how much danger am I in? So I called the police, and I said, I'm terribly frightened. When they arrived, I introduced them to Jeff, and in this case, they came in plain clothing. They weren't in police uniforms. Now, they could have handcuffed him, I guess, and pulled him out, but they are taught how different that person is that they're dealing with. So they began to talk to Jeff. If they can get the person that's ill to, in their own mind, they're cooperating, it's far less violent, it's better for the patient, and certainly it's better for our police.
When nonviolent people go to jail with mental illness, they say it's 3 or 4 times longer than a violent offender. But when they get released, if they're not hooked up into treatment, they're going to be right back in. There are so many people in their emergency rooms who shouldn't be there. The previous police chief here has actually kept data on how long his officers were spending in emergency rooms waiting for psycho valves and medical clearance, 8 to 14 hours. He spends $600,000 a year in overtime. Now here at the Restoration Center, the law enforcement officers are in and out within 15 minutes.
What we have here at the Restoration Center is services to patients who are in crisis. It's either walk-in or brought in here by CIT. They recognize the patient's in crisis. They're not truly suicidal. They don't really want to hurt somebody. They just need help.
There are about 18,000 people a year who are brought mainly by law enforcement officers to this Restoration Center who used to go to jail, emergency rooms, or put back on the street. If you're a taxpayer and really don't know a lot about mental illness, the fact that the public's a lot safer when these people get treated, and the taxpayer saves a ton of money.
That's a Texas term, a ton of money.
Over the last 5 years, we saved about $50 million in taxpayers' dollars.
But we want everyone trained because of the potential daily that someone's going to come across someone who's in crisis. It's not a matter of if. It's a matter of how soon.
We've been coming up on 6 years of existence, and we don't have a use of force on our unit, which means we've never tased anybody, we've never shot anybody, we've never hit anybody with an ask. But patients, talking to them, we get the result we want in the end, and we don't have to force it on them.
You want CIT to respond because you're going to get the help that you need rather than being sent to jail.
The issues that police officers have with people who have mental illness is not unique to San Antonio. That's all over the country, all over the world. So any city that would decide to focus on this, put an emphasis on this, would certainly benefit from it.
I no longer thought, what if they have to shoot, Jeff?
We save money, we improve public safety, and people can get functional again. I mean, why wouldn't you do this? It's really a no-brainer.
So the next film, so remember it said there were about 18,000 people a year that were right there, whether they take to jail or emergency rooms, back on the street. So we decided to market to our number one customer, and that was law enforcement. So the next film you'll see is called Roll Call. So we're up to about 30,000 people a year that are brought to the crisis center, who used to go to jail or emergency rooms. And so we'll watch that, and I'll talk a little bit about our outcomes, which are pretty old.
Population of San Antonio?
1.8 million to 2 million.
The following message is from the Center for Healthcare Services, proudly serving law enforcement and first responders in our community.
If you have an intoxicated person on your hands, bring them here.
You have an emergency detention? Bring them here.
Do you have an injured prisoner that needs medical attention? Bring them here.
Within the last few months, the Restoration Center has made tremendous efforts towards the speed and delivery of services for law enforcement officers in our community. Hello, I'm Brittany Berry, Clinic Administrator for the Mobile Crisis Outreach Team. We've made a number of improvements to assist law enforcement officers with prisoners and people in crisis on an ED needing medical attention. Over 1,400 people per month are diverted and connected to quality care in an effort to reduce arrests and emergency room visits. Welcome to the Restoration Center.
Our goal is to provide fast service delivery in order to take the individual, AP, inebriate, or ED off your hands, or provide medical attention to your prisoner so you can get in and out and back into service quickly.
The Restoration Center cannot take violent individuals. They don't have seclusion or restraints.
The Restoration Center does not take juveniles.
If a person is seriously injured or suspected of an overdose, you should go to the nearest emergency room.
Honestly, if the person is that seriously injured, EMS needs to transport them to the ER.
Just remember, the rumor about calling ahead is not true. But if you do have questions, call this number.
If you're not familiar with the location, 601 North Rio is downtown, less than a mile from the MAG. The entrance is off pavement for Hope Way.
This is where you park.
Whether you have an injured prisoner, emergency detention, or an inebriate, they'll take them off your hands quickly and get you back on the streets as soon as possible.
EDs, 15 minutes or less.
Inebriates, no wait time, just drop them off.
A place to sit down and write your report.
Injured prisoners are served immediately, not like long waiting times in emergency rooms.
24 hours a day.
7 days a week, 365 days a year.
At the Restoration Center, law enforcement is our primary customer. The Restoration Center thanks you for your service.
That was easy.
Yeah, they have it all here. We were in and out. I wonder why more guys won't use this place.
No kidding. Maybe we could tell those guys at the Restoration Center to make a video so we can get the word out. And you know what? Maybe you can even start it.
No, man. I'm too shy and you're too ugly.
So we took this video when we first started, and we took it to all the police and sheriff's substations every quarter and showed it all three shifts. And so that's how we got to the 30,000. Now both the San Antonio Police Department.
One of the police department's mission to change their approach to interactions with the mentally ill. Many of us know someone who struggles with mental illness, but when cops are called into the picture, these encounters can turn deadly.
Can we kill that one? So that was a Nightline interview done by Nightline. I don't know if you saw it, where they interviewed a couple of our law enforcement officers. So we get a lot of news media and a lot of, and so we could have spent the whole time looking at videos. But both the sheriff and the police chief in San Antonio have put this film in their academies, and they do the 40-hour crisis intervention training for every new law enforcement officers. So most places say that's too expensive, we don't invest that much, we can't take officers off the street that long.
But I'm convinced that McManus, who is the San Antonio police chief, was the first big police chief in the United States to require all these officers to go through the 40-hour training. And it's because he wanted his officers to have additional skills besides what they usually teach in the academies. So academies have been kind of militarized over the years. So you're taught how to use your weapons. You spend more time learning how to shoot your gun than about behavioral health issues. And you use your command voice, command presence. Well, the problem with that is you need those hard skills probably about 5 to 10% of your encounters with the public. Most of your encounters with the public are going to be you need to calm down. You know, their family disturbance, their mental health calls, like we saw in Ferguson, some kind of racially tense call. And if you're using your command voice and your command presence with those things, people, behaviors escalate. People get hurt. Law enforcement officers get hurt and the public gets hurt. So I really think that the chief wants his officers to have additional skills in their belt, not just all these hard skills. In fact, he won't let you carry a taser unless you've been through the 40-hour training because he wants you to use de-escalation techniques before any kind of crisis. The sheriff, she not only has her deputies trained, but her jailers trained. So jails are tense places, and when things get out of hand, the sheriff doesn't want the first line of defense. It's called the goon squad. You saw the guys with the mask on, dragging that mentally ill guy out of his cell, and he suffocated. She wants them to use de-escalation techniques first. See if you can step back. Calm the situation down so the officers and jailers don't get hurt and the detainees in jail don't get hurt. So the homeless count downtown San Antonio, we just had our point in time count a few months ago. You had it here too. Since we opened this crisis unit up and our homeless campus, the homeless count is down 88% downtown San Antonio. I told you 2,000 empty beds in the county jail. There's a reduction of over 50% of inappropriate people going to emergency rooms and to hospitals. So we have all this data, it's all auditable, and so we get a lot of investment from the city and the county and the hospitals. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that. So can we go to the next slide? So we talked about most of this. In that roll call slide, there are a couple things I want to kind of correct. So it says we don't take people who are dangerous. Everybody that's brought to our crisis center is potentially dangerous. It's just law enforcement officers are so good at de-escalating behavior and our staff that people are de-escalated and talked down. We do not have a seclusion room because we don't want to duplicate services. So the University Health System, who trains psychiatrists, has a partnership with the medical school. They do have a locked unit, so if somebody's actually knocking down walls and we don't think we can handle them, they go to that unit because we don't want to duplicate services. But probably 99.9% of people who are detained and brought to us in some kind of mental health crisis, are de-escalated. It says we don't take people that are medically compromised. Well, what we found is law enforcement officers are so convenient. They were dropping people off there who had ingested something. So we have medical services, but we can't pump your stomach. If you're a pregnant female, you need to go to a specialized unit, and it's not us. It's someplace else. So there's some rules. So we kind of put that in there so we can always remind law enforcement officers, call us if somebody's medically compromised. But we do have a lot of medical services, and we keep a lot of data. And so... one of the things, I kind of go back a little bit. So when we first started, and one of the reasons we get a lot of attention because we have so much data on all the things I'm talking about, so I can actually prove everything I say today because most people think that's got to be too good, he's got to be lying. So, the White House has this data, this Stepping Up Initiative on what they call it, Criminal Justice Data Initiative or something like that. Lynn Overman, who went to the Arnold Foundation. But so they've been and looked at our data, and we've had lots of people look at that. And it's all auditable, and we have formulas associated with it. So when we first started that little crisis unit, we got census. We were in the second round of the census jail diversion initiative. And there were three rounds. All three rounds did the same thing except for us. They put somebody in jail to identify people with mental illness and try to do discharge planning, so when they got out, they could try to engage them and get them into treatment so they didn't decompensate and go back to jail and have visions for all the door. Well, in our little community collaboration, we had family members and consumers and other people. And before we wrote our SAMHSA grant, we developed some value statements. And one of the values we decided on is somebody shouldn't be criminalized for having an illness. So when we wrote the jail diversion grant, what we concentrated on was keeping people out of jail who shouldn't go there. So we actually had a true diversion program. And so we, you know, SAMHSA, we kept a lot of data. So we were actually asking law enforcement officers who were bringing people to our crisis unit, if you hadn't brought them here, where would you have taken them? So if they said jail, that was a jail diversion, okay? If they said emergency rooms, it was an emergency room diversion. So we, you know, we have this data. So we're graphing and charting all this stuff. And so we see a huge reduction of people going to emergency rooms inappropriately and going to jails inappropriately. And all of a sudden, we saw this little tick upwards from people who were going back to jail in emergency rooms. So we had this community collaboration like your community has. And so the person who represented law enforcement was a guy named Captain Harry Griffin, who worked for the San Antonio Police Department. And Harry's to the right of Attila the Hun. You know, he is the toughest, you know, ex-Marine, San Antonio police cop that there's ever been. But he was devoted to this diversion program. I don't know if he had a mentally ill person in his family or he just thought it was wrong that law enforcement officers should have to deal with people who were ill. So Harry was a great leader in making sure that the San Antonio Police Department and other law enforcement officers were good partners. And we also had a guy that was in charge of the University Health System's emergency room, Dr. Natan. And so the three of us were meeting when we saw this data of where people were going back to jail emergency rooms. And we were trying to figure out what's going on. And so Dr. Natal said to Captain Griffin, you know, your San Antonio Police Department are starting to bring people back to emergency rooms who are inappropriate. They should have gone to the crisis center at 711 East Josephine. And so Captain Griffin said, here, and he said, Dr. Natal, get their badge numbers. I went, whoa. And so he did. He collected the badge numbers. He actually went out to the substations and confronted these law enforcement officers who were taking people to jail and back to the emergency room and said, why are you doing this? Why aren't you taking them to this crisis unit? And what he heard was this. So our doctors who worked at the crisis unit, psychiatrists, most psychiatrists haven't done primary care since they were in medical school and never did a rotation. So from time to time, less than 2% of the time, somebody would come in that had a history of congestive heart failure or liver disease. Our doctors would say, would you mind taking them and getting them medical clearance? If they're okay, bring them back. Well, law enforcement officers don't like to be taxing services, right? They don't like to be running people around all the time. They certainly don't like to be ordered around by somebody that's not in their chain of command. So the word on the street, even though it wasn't true, is don't even take them to 711 East Josephine because they're just going to tell you to take them to emergency rooms or jail. And so that was the common knowledge. So then we decided, okay, we got to find a way to do medical clearance and psych evals in the same place. So the hospital district had already seen this huge decrease in unfunded people going to emergency rooms and get bedded in the hospital. So the old county hospitals, downtown San Antonio, they had developed it into a big outpatient program. So women's health and children's health and a bunch of primary care stuff. But they also had an urgent care center there. So they had access to lab work and x-rays and all that. So we moved our crisis unit into a suite, an empty suite that they had there. So all of a sudden we could do medical clearance and psych evals in the same place, right? The problem with that is they didn't run at night on weekends. So I'm the mental health authority, I'm not the health authority, but I found a way to fund those, to keep that medical clearance open on night and weekends. And it was very expensive to do that. So remember, this is all about a community partnership, driving out waste and duplication. So what we're hearing from our partners and law enforcement officers is people that shouldn't go to our crisis unit, they still have these minor medical emergencies. So you arrest somebody and there's a scuffle and there's a small cut, and these officers would have to take folks to the emergency room. They get triaged to the back of the line because they were in a car wreck, didn't have a heart attack. And they wait several hours and finally get sewn up and get their tetanus shot, they take them to jail. So we tell our partners, law enforcement, bring it to us. It's a minor medical emergency. We'll somebody get a tetanus shot. You take them to jail, you're right back on the street, you don't have to wait. several hours. So we have this you know, love affair with law enforcement, and they have a love affair with us. And so, you know, that's what people are always, you know, astounded at is, you know, how do you get mental health and law enforcement and all these other people that are partnered? Well, we do it because we're open to continuous quality improvement, to change, we're open to criticism, we're open to collecting data. Okay, so next slide.
We're probably going to have to
let
people
you.
Ask some questions.
Yeah.
You could go for,
I could have go for
8 hours.
Hours.
And, but if anyone has any questions, if you would hand them.
Okay, my concern or my input would be, why don't they have, if I live in, let's say, Kalashua County, it's the best example, and I have a son or a daughter with mental health, why isn't there like a hotline or a registry line that anyone with mental health can be on, that the police has access to the data, so this is the emergency room, and they have like this maybe neon type of bracelet, so that when they see that bracelet, instead of approaching them as a criminal, they're approaching them as a mental health patient.
So in San Antonio, we do have that common database. We don't have the neon bracelet because we don't want to identify people as having an illness. And our officers are trained, so they do have. This slide here, I always tell people I can prove that treatment works. So the Texas prison system puts nonviolent mentally ill offenders on parole. And the criminal justice system in Texas, the prison system, pays me for treatment, not the mental health system. And the condition of their parole is they got to see my psychiatrist, do their alcohol and drug screen if so ordered, take their medication, generally stay in compliance with mental health treatment. So felons on parole, 3 to 5 years out, the revocation rate, so 40 to 60%, if you have a mental illness, is a little bit higher. In other words, you get rearrested, go back to jail or prison. Guess what it is in Bexar County, you can see it there, when you get treated by us, it's 6.6%. Most of those are technical revocations where we round the person back up and get in front of their psychiatrist and we get them back in front of their parole officer. So treatment works, so we do a lot of conditional treatment. We provide the treatment to the mental health courts, the drug courts, the family courts, the children's courts, the veterans courts. And
where's CFCD? Top 10
CSCDs.
What does that mean?
Yeah, thank you.
Oh, thank you.
So this is not my slide. This is the state criminal justice slide because they keep the data.
Okay.
We've got Leah.
Yes.
Why do you have something to add?
If the sheriff was here, she'd want to share that we do have Smart 911 available to address what you're bringing up, that an individual can go on and self-register what their particular illnesses, how they would like to be addressed by the police. So we do have a system available. We probably are not as good at marketing it, and that is a nationwide system.
Right, and I know you're looking at a mental health app also that would have all the crisis information on it. So, other questions?
You got a question over there?
Yes, sir.
With this system that you use, do you only pull out misdemeanors, or do you use felonies or take people with mental health issues and pull them out with felonies?
Yes, sir. We do. So if there's any way the law enforcement officers can look back, so we've had people who have assaulted officers, and in Texas, officers have discretion. So if the officer thought the reason that you punched him or kicked him was because of your mental illness, they can bring you to the crisis unit and not charge you for an assault, and that happens. So we divert all these people, you know, 30,000 from the front end. So we have a second diversion point we're working with the Council of Governments on. So every law enforcement officer in Bexar County, all the municipalities have law enforcement officers, have agreed to ask 4 questions upon persons being detained or arrested. You know, do you have a mental illness? What medications are you on? Are you thinking about hurting yourself or somebody else? And the county's actually hired us to have staff at bookend. And so a lot of people still slip through that safety net of being diverted to our crisis unit. So our staff does a mental health assessment and a dangerous assessment. Then we turn to the judge. This is where you go to jail. And we say, Judge, would you consider a mental health bond or a personal incompetence bond? Because this person has a mental illness, and if you agree to release them conditionally to treatment, their danger scale is very low, so they're probably not gonna hurt themselves or anybody else. So one of the slides I have here later on shows the results of that. And that's a special project with the Council on Governments, Dr. Fred Osher. So if you come to treatment, we take you to treatment right then if the judge will give you a conditional release. 4% of the people that go to treatment have some kind of recidivism. Over 90% of those folks actually show up for their court day. And we've got the data about if the judge did do the mental health bond, what would have happened? And the recidivism rate is 27%, and the number of people that don't show up for their court day with this population is like 48%. So these programs really work, and so we divert another bunch of people. So they're not shutting down pods in the jail per se. They're not taking money and giving it to me. What they're doing is they're improving services in the jail. And so so the sheriff's got all these great reentry programs and jail education programs and other things. So we're just not warehousing people anymore. They're taking the money that they would have been spent if they had an additional 1,000 people in the jail and redesigning how people who are arrested and go to jail get treated.
We have time for one more question.
So if somebody goes to the restoration center, are they stabilized? What happens to them after that? And then does the restoration center do anything with them as far as like going to court with them or anything like that? Or?
Yeah, so they're not charged. They go to the restoration center, they have no papers, they're not charged at all. Law enforcement officers can basically drop them off. So if you go through the sobering detox, in the sobering unit, when you come in, we used to have beds, but the people were so impaired they were falling out of beds and they're hurting themselves. So now we have mats on the floor. Everybody in that unit's in recovery themselves, so we're treating people with dignity and respect, we're giving them showers. And I've been in there when our staff have been on their heads and knees saying, hey, I used to be sick and thrown up like you. On the other side of that wall is a detox center. Don't you want to go get some help? About 20% of those folks a month choose to go to detox. It's voluntary. And it's one of the biggest reasons that the homeless count in this downtown San Antonio is down so much. So detox is a necessary intervention that doesn't work. You all probably know friends and other folks who have been to detox over and over again. They fall off the wagon, they relapse. There are people like Lindsay Lohan in our newspaper all the time. So what's important is after your detox is how you maintain your sobriety. So in the main part of the homeless campus, is alcohol and drug free. We operate two dorms called in-house recovery. They're 120-day programs. And so all the staff there is in recovery. We use an evidence-based treatment seeking safety. But you're there long enough, your brain chemistry kicks in, you start figuring out what you've done to your children, your family, your friends, yourself. You're learning about your disease. You're learning how to manage your disease. We start hooking you up with that higher power of your own choosing and other support systems in the community. We start working on jobs and housing. So we don't have any swimming pools to swim in, no beaches to walk on, no sunsets to look at, no horses to ride. But that in-house recovery unit, a year after you go through that full course of treatment, over 50% of those people are still clean and sober. That's better than Betty Ford, and we're talking about street drunks that have mental illnesses. So what's important is how you maintain sobriety. So they're in there 120 days or more. That's the secret to sobriety. It's not the detox, because the detox is so short. Most of you know, the insurance companies authorize 5 to 7 days according to what kind of substance you're addicted to.
If they're not inebriated or intoxicated, do you refer them out for psych services? What do you do with them after they're stabilized?
Well, we have outpatient programs and other kinds of things to continue to support them. Sure.
Thank you.
We gotta get you to the
I can speak all day. God bless. Thank you. Keep up the good work.